All right, so I'm going to get started. I'm Lisa Bradley. Hi. Something that I like to do is know everybody's name when we're in a group this small. So Terry, Margaret, Vicky, Phyllis, Barbara, Judy, Bill, Gary, Carl, right? Everybody, what's my name? Yay! Give yourselves a round of applause. Excellent job! Very good. Well, I've worn many hats in my lifetime, and one of them is school teacher. I love to share what I know. That's my definition of teaching. And very often, somebody will have something that I need to know. So, unfortunately, we have to quit at 5. They're going to kick us out, and we need to actually stop a few minutes before 5. My talk usually is about 2 hours. Unfortunately, I usually don't take a break because once I really get in the zone and I'm rolling, I don't want to quit for breaks. So if you feel that you want to, use the restroom or whatever. Judy, did we have water? No? Okay. So you guys all brought water. I see most of you guys have what you need. So just take care of your own needs, you know, whatever you need to do today.
About the parking, 2 hours.
I know, right? I had to park up the hill, right?
Are they strict
about it? Yeah, I saw a lady marking the tires out there.
Okay, well, I'll probably leave it for then.
Okay. Or you could scoot out and move the car midway and come back.
<That's really> hard.
Good. I've written a book, and I'm deep into my first sequel. This is the first book of fiction that I've written. It's called Abby Wise Away, A-W long A, and it's about a 13-year-old horse-loving girl who's suddenly thrown into the far future when world peace has finally arrived. People always ask me how long did it take me to write it. It took me about 3 years of actual typing, editing, revising, submitting, publishing, so on and so forth. But I can't discount the additional 5 years of notes and thinking about it that came just prior to that, nor can I discount the approximately 15 years before that of living and life experiences and observing. And actually, I can't discount the additional 30 years or so that came before all that in my childhood, because in my book, I start at Abby's birth. That's my starting point. It's mentioned in there. So in my particular case, I have a degree in journalism. Actually, I double majored in journalism and art from the University of Nebraska-Lincoln many years ago. And when it came time for me to begin writing this novel, I took into account that people said writing fiction is a lot harder than nonfiction. And I thought, yeah, well, but I'm smarter than the average Jolene, and I've been writing for many years. I'm not just, falling off the carrot truck yesterday. And I have a degree in journalism. I'm a trained writer. No, they were right. Fiction is way, way harder than nonfiction. Way harder. Why? Because there's characters to develop, the feeling, the flow. You have to have internal consistency of something that you're largely making up. And so if somebody's hair is dark brown in this scene, it better not be blonde, 20 chapters later. And on and on. It's very, very challenging. However, I'm really, really pleased that I made a promise to myself that I wanted to write a really good book, and the feedback indicates that I succeeded. What is involved in doing that is a lot of effort and time. A lot. Unbelievable. As I mentioned, I majored in art. Drawing is not one of my strong points, but all kinds of other things are. Quilting, pottery, photography, on and on and on. And of all the art forms that I've done, writing fiction is by far the hardest, by far. It's just massive amounts of time and slogging through it and effort and try again and go get feedback because you're lost and all of this eats up time.
Did you write fiction as a child?
I dabbled, and for school assignments, but I mean, not much, right? Not much. So, however, I read voraciously, and if you know, if I can mention one thing that is absolutely required to be a good writer, it's to read voraciously. Like you can't breathe unless you've read something new that day. That's the level of intensity you have to have about reading something new. So when I first envisioned writing this book, I envisioned going the usual route of finding a publisher, and they would, you know, do all the hard work and the layout for me, and I would say yay or nay, and they would do my marketing for me, and we'd be off and running. Well, that didn't happen. For several reasons. One is that there's a lot of spirituality in my book. I included Native American, Episcopalian, which I grew up as, and Baha'i, which I am now. And
what are you now?
Baha'i, a member of the Baha'i faith. And so there's enough of religious things in there that I knew I needed somebody that was savvy about religion. I'm dealing with prophecies about, you know, the future perfect world to come and all kinds of things. And just not any old editor could go through this, right? So I started with the Baha'i Publishing Trusts, and there are only about four or five of them in the world, and so that's who I had envisioned would publish my book, right? I have a niche book, and or that's how I had originally perceived it. Well, they all turned me down, and I was like, gah, what now? I mean, I was really, and it took 6 months for them to go through it and turn me down. Time's a ticking, right? And I was like, okay, now what? So I got online with my writers group. I'm a member of an online writers group. And I said, wah, they'll turn me down, wah. And this one fellow, Justice St. Rain, for those of you who might know his name, he was in one of these flip moods that day, and he got back on and he said, so self-publish. And I said, wah, because I'm terrified, I can't do that. And he said, well, people do it all the time. There's this outfit right down the road, Author House, that they, you know, they do this full time, and people, you know, seem to come out of that okay. Well, with that sort of non-endorsement, I looked up authorhouse.com and went through their website, and I knew he was not giving me the full scoop. I knew there would be a steep learning curve, but I didn't see that I had a choice if I wanted this sucker to be published, all right? I also knew that I was going to have to get my own editor, because one of the things that was pounded into me in journalism school is that every writer needs an editor, and we're going to get into that in a little bit in my PowerPoint, why and how to deal with that. But I did. I found myself an editor, and I contacted Author House, and you know, kind of the learning curve was very steep, but I'm not unhappy with the results for reasons that I'm going to show you in the PowerPoint. There are definite advantages to self-publishing. All right, so here we go. Each of you are here because you have some project in mind, whether it's book or, you know, some kind of publication. We're going to talk today about writing, publishing, and promoting. Terry? Here's what we're going to cover today, the self-publishing, self-promoting writer. So 3 points. What is this whole thing called self-publishing? What is that? Also, how do I know if I can or should write the book in mind? We're going to deal with that whole writing part of it. And thirdly, what is self-promoting and how do I do it? The self-promoting part is actually like only 2 slides worth. It comes at the very, very end, because by the time I get there, that's going to be the simplest part to explain. Terry? Thank you. All right, so let's start. What is self-publishing, also called vanity publishing, also called print on demand? Okay, all three of those are synonymous. It's a new industry. We're still trying to figure out what to call it, but basically those are all three the same thing. All right, so if you prefer another term, you know, rather than the one I use, just as long as we've got our terms defined, we can have a conversation about what this is. It is a way to publish your book when a traditional contract publisher, what I have on the far right over there, contract publishing, turns down your book, or if for some reason that avenue does not appeal to you. And there are definite reasons why that traditional contract publishing, as I call it, may not be your cup of tea. So self-publishing is in the middle, contract publishing is at one end, and then totally like do-it-yourself publishing, like at home on your own computer, or take your memory stick down to the copy store. That's sometimes what people think self-publishing means, but that's not what I mean. Is that clear? Have we got our terms figured out? Okay, Terry? Great. So we have to think about the end in the beginning, interestingly enough, with this whole self-publishing thing. So you have your final product, whatever, that, let's call it a book, all right, that you're going to be publishing. You have to think about where you're going to publish it, under what circumstances, how it's going to be distributed, what the costs are going to be, your readership, all right? And then if I could have, I would have made a line between each of those outer bubbles as well, because everything influences everything else in this endeavor. So you really do have to begin thinking about the end when you're starting your project. Terry? Great. So let's talk about broad categories of books that you all might be thinking of making. So there's children's picture books. There are young adult fiction and nonfiction. That's what mine is. Mine is young adult fiction, okay? However, it also is written at a high enough level of literacy that it also has been placed in adult fiction categories as well. So mine is actually dual. So comic books, graphic novels is another category, and then adult coffee table picture books, nonfiction and fiction. Now, there are many, many more categories of books than this, obviously, if we're going to get into genre, right? If we're going to get into genre, for example, poetry, right? And board books for babies, and, you know, let alone the genres of mystery versus suspense, romance, on and on and on. But those really don't matter as much as just starting to get a handle on what printing realities are there. What is it going to take to physically produce your book? These are the realities that you have to think of in the beginning. All right?
Terry?
Mm-hmm. Good. Well, let's talk about artwork, because artwork, really, interestingly enough, has a lot of influence on your final product, if you're going to have artwork or not. Now, you all know the saying that a picture is worth 1,000 words, and it's true. When I've sat at book booths and book fairs or whatever, very often people come up, they pick up my book, they don't read my blurbs that I labored so hard on, they flip through, and what are they looking for, do you think? Artwork. They don't care what. Something more than just straight words, right? And these are often people who are very literate, but they want the extra visual. And as an artist, I completely agree with them, all right? So my particular book, just so you know where I'm coming from, it does have artwork inside. I have some fonts, I have some pictures, there's a picture puzzle that takes place throughout the book. Some boxed items, okay, and then at the end I have a little bit more artwork. And then what I wanted to do in my book was I wanted to include a craft project in every book, because I'm writing a series, okay? So for example, these two little cross stitch patches that are on the cover, that stands for No Hate and World Peace. Okay, I designed those and the graphs to stitch those, and the instructions are in the back. Okay? So all of that took a phenomenal amount of time and planning and so on. It's so much easier to just make straight words, but it has a lot less visual and emotional appeal to the reader, to the consumer. So this is an example of a hand-drawn chart for my No Hate counter cross stitch patch. And fortunately, the editor that I wound up using has killer computer skills. Thank God, right? So she made me the awesome professional chart that's in the book. But this is what I sent her to work off of, right? I also, being a former professional photographer, photographed my own book cover. And because I'm a journalist as well, I document everything, usually in pictures. So lucky you, I have documented for you my high-tech, high-dollar, not photo studio where I did my book cover. All right, so if you notice, I've got aluminum foil here. You can't see it, but there's aluminum foil here. This is an ironing board. There's every portable lamp I had in the house gathered around there to illumine my layout. Okay, and we stood on the step stool and bent over like this. No, it's crooked. No, it's still crooked. Okay, that's how we did the cover. So if you compare what's laid out on my sewing room floor with this, and then we photoshopped the rest of it, my son and I. And I mean, it was really, you know, crawling through that landmine in the dark. But it's amazing when you have a little bit of knowledge and you know how to use the internet and you know how to use, you know, use friendships, what you can get done for like zero money. It was, we did that all ourselves, and I'm really pleased with it. And then it just takes, you know, an eye to arrange the text on top of the graphics. But that layout was there for like months. I was like, no, don't anybody walk in that room. Oh, the breeze is, shut all the windows. It's windy. It might blow my, you know, nuts. Totally amateur, but it worked. It worked because I know design principles. I had a strong vision of what I wanted, and I was able to cobble together the equipment, right? So just in case you're, anybody's under the misimpression that all the artwork takes, you know, big money and massive skill and, you know, whatever, it doesn't. You can kind of inch your way through it, okay? And it really, really, the good artwork really adds to the product. Okay, Terry. Well, let's talk about an illustrator then, okay? Because drawing is not one of my, you know, the art skills in my repertoire. So I was fortunate enough to locate a lady who is willing to do the artwork that I wanted in my book, basically for free. And she was really, really wonderful to work with. So as you see on the front cover, I have an Appaloosa horse because my character, Abby, is a horse lover, and I have her doing horses, and everything on the cover is actually written into the plot of the book. So my little character, Abby, draws that horse and this one as well, okay? Well, since I don't draw, right, I needed to find somebody who could and do it like a 13-year-old. So when I located this other friend, Judy Russell is her name, she lives in Washington State, and I located her through that writer's group, and I sent her this picture of an actual pony that I owned. And then I said, I need, you know, this leopard Appaloosa pony to just be kind of one picture walking, another rearing with, you know. And so I had to communicate with her. This is one of the skills that you as project director, you as you know, the person with the vision, has to be able to communicate. And so I did my line drawings, you know, just enough for her to get a good idea of what I wanted, and then she got the spotted picture, and then she kind of, you know, put it all together. And there was some back and forth. We didn't meet until the book was published and done. So we were working by fax and mail, and including at one point she was in China, and she was having to get me some pictures all the way from China. So there's some work involved. That's where I you know, just mentioned that it can be very, very difficult and require perseverance. So, Terry? Good. Let's talk about the editing for a little bit. So every writer needs an editor. I mentioned that. The reason why you have to think about who's going to edit your work is that when you're well into a work, any kind of creation, you lose objectivity. right? The further you sink down into it, it doesn't matter what it is. Sewing, kid raising, book writing, you know, interior decorating, any field. You lose objectivity once you're so far into it. And yet, you need somebody to kind of tell you, you know, oh, this doesn't flow, or this doesn't match, or it's not making sense, or okay. You can't tell anymore. You've lost your objectivity. You're, you know, just in the trenches, and you need somebody up above. That's one of the main purposes of an editor, all right? There are other people that can just simply read and give it what's called a secretary test. I heard it called a secretary test. So a secretary test is that somebody that has basic knowledge and basic intelligence, but no specialized knowledge about the topic, and it's their first read. They're coming onto it cold. That's very, very valuable. And what I do anymore is when I'm talking with people, and if the conversation goes a certain way, and they might say, wow, I would love to, you know, I would love to lay eyeballs on the manuscript of your first sequel, what I call Book B. And I write them down. I collect those names. Those are so valuable, that feedback at an early stage. Yeah, I'm going to hold off most comments until the end. Yeah. So when you have an editor who's committed to work with you over the long term, and be your, you know, objective voice, right? You have to make sure that that's somebody whose voice you like. You have to make sure that you like, you know, who they are, their basic personality, right? And do you all have the same vision? It's a little bit difficult to know in the beginning of an endeavor whether you're going to like your editor or not. And now that I've been through the process, I always read the acknowledgments to see, even did the writer acknowledge their editor, and if so, what did they say? And it's pretty funny once you really get, you know, reading this with some knowledge, because very often I'll read like, she liked the finished product but hated working together with her or him, you know, because being writers, you can kind of say stuff without saying stuff, right? We know how to use words, and so you can put things down there that indicate, yeah, they didn't like totally love each other, I guess. So what we need to do when we're talking to somebody about being our editor is we need to just kind of have a little free flow. You know, do we like them as a person, and do we, you know, are they comfortable with the type of work I'm trying to produce, you know, that sort of thing. So if somebody goes with a contract publisher, they provide the editor, and you're kind of stuck with whoever it is. You might have a little bit of leeway in who, but you might be stuck with whoever it is. If you self-publish, you have your choice of who you use as an editor. Now, my editor basically worked for free because once she saw the manuscript, she believed in it so much, she just wanted to see it, you know, written and produced, and she wanted her granddaughter to read it. So, you know, I did pay her not nearly what she was worth, and that's one of those things where if you're fortunate, you can get somebody that just believes in you and your product, and is willing to, you know, do it for not much money. If you have the luxury of self-publishing and finding your own editor, you have to be able to talk money and deadlines and these arrangements. Because if somebody says, oh yeah, raise your hand if you've had this cartoon. Oh yeah, I'll do it. Never happens, right? I mean, no matter what it is, painting or having that dinner party or, you know, right? And people all the time say, oh yeah, it doesn't happen. So you don't want that person to be your editor, right? If you're the person looking for an editor, you have to make sure that, like, they're going to make space in their life for you, whether it's paid or whether it's volunteer. So you have to come into this knowing it's going to be kind of like a marriage, only worse. You know, and pick carefully. That's my advice. Okay, Tara. All right, so let's talk a little bit about self-publishing versus contract publishing, the pros and cons. So here on the self-publishing side, there are many options, many, many. It's almost like too many options sometimes, all the choices that go with self-publishing. I recommend that you have a completed, hopefully polished manuscript. That's what, you know, publishing biz, it's MS for manuscript, in hand before you purchase your package. Because here's how self-publishing works. You pick, you know, a company, Author House, whatever, I'll give you a few other names later on. And you buy the right, or you buy their services to take your manuscript, put it in the format that you say that you want it, get it in their system so that it can be printed. And then usually the self-publishing houses are print on demand. That, as far as I know, that's true. What that means is that they put it in their system and they send you usually, like, let's say a couple dozen books. With Author House, they sent, I paid extra to have my book available in soft cover and hardcover. Okay, I paid a little bit extra for that. So let's say you buy, you have your book just in soft cover, all right? So you're going to get 22 books, let's say, in soft cover right after it's produced. And then you can sell those, donate them, whatever you want to do with those 22. Once those 22 run out, somebody has to buy them. Where do they buy them? From your publisher, or depending on if your publisher then goes ahead and lists them for you on Amazon with the Uber distributors. I'm going to get into that in a minute. Local bookstores, so on and so forth. Well, when an order's placed with Amazon, a national bookstore, a local bookstore, whatever, the order goes back up the chain and your publisher prints that book right then and there and ships it off to whoever ordered it. That's why it's called print on demand. It's not that there's a warehouse sitting with 10,000 of your books somewhere. It's printed when it's paid for and ordered. Does that make sense? That's what print on demand is. As far as I know, all self-publishing companies are print on demand basis. Okay? I mean, you can order up 10,000 if you want and have them sitting in some warehouse, right? But you don't have to. That's the difference, right? So when I purchased my package, I thought that I had a finished manuscript in hand. Not. What I had was a polished rough draft. I didn't know that because I didn't have my editor yet and I hadn't gone through the whole revision process. So once I found my editor, once I realized I was going to be self-publishing, and my editor started going through this, and we started really taking a look at it, it had grown cold to me. The manuscript script had grown cold to my eyes. So when I looked at it again, I was like, what? You know, chop and slice and dice, and, you know, I realized that I had a lot more work to do, let alone what my editor found. Right? So it was 2 years between the time that I bought my package and I hit the send button. Final. Okay? I don't recommend that. The reason why is that publishing is changing so fast. Raise your hand if you know of somebody or have had it happen yourself that a publishing house went out of business and took a contract of somebody you know with them. Okay? Yeah. This is what's happening, like, every week. Every week another publishing house goes out of business, and they have had all these contracts out to people for incoming work. Those are all null and void when the company goes out of business, right? So there was more than once that I was like, yikes, is Author House going to go out of business and take my money with them, right? And it was $1,100. It was $1,100, the package that I bought, right? And I didn't have that money to waste. That was scrounged and scrimped, right? I couldn't do it again. So not only for the reason of look out for your publishing house going out of business if you wait too long between paying and publishing, but also the rules keep changing, right? Because publishing houses, the reason that they're going out of business so fast is that the industry is in real trouble. The industry is in real trouble, friends. What that means is that they have to keep changing the rules in order to stay in business. So therefore, maybe the price increased. Maybe the deadlines got longer. Maybe the, okay? because they're just trying to stay in business, so they have to change things that cost, you know, time and cost money. So I strongly recommend, if you do self-publish, that you shop around, you know, look, see which company you think you might want to go with, but don't buy until you're just almost super positive that you have the finished deal in hand and you've gone over and over and over and over and over it, whether with their editor or one that you found. Because a lot of the self-publishing houses do offer editing, but wow, is it pricey. I mean, wow. Like, mine would have been like $8,000 to edit. Plus, that wasn't even a possibility because their editors didn't have the spiritual knowledge, the religious background that I needed them to have. So it was never an option anyway. Choose a company that seems to offer what you need, but know what you probably need first. Back to that end in the beginning thing again. What do I need, you have to ask yourself, based on your project. So, do you need an editor? At what level? There's all kinds of different levels of editing. Everything from just straight out punctuation and capitalization, that's a basic proofreading level, all the way through ghostwriter. Okay, ghostwriter is somebody that takes your idea, writes it for you, and lets you put your name on it. Okay, that's the highest level. My editor, Lucky Wilder, she at one point joked that she should be listed as co-author, and she wasn't far off. But I realized that it wasn't quite to that level, but almost. She was instrumental. The book would not exist without her. Instrumental. Layout help. Well, how is your book going to look, right? There's all kinds of decisions. So this is another reason to read all the time. Look at layouts. For example, you're going to have to make the decision if you have a chapter book. Are you okay with the chapter starting on the left hand? If the previous chapter ends on the right and you have the left-hand page blank, could you start there? Or do you want that page to be blank and all new chapters start on the right, on the odd page? This is a layout question. And fortunately, I had layout and typography and other things in my journalism training, and so I had some opinions on that. But if this is brand new to you, you need an opinion. And the best way to do that is look at works with your own work in mind. Look at similar works to the type of work you want to do. And look at everything from the typeface they used, is it easy or hard to read, the margins, how much white space, type size, where did they put the page number, chapter headings, do you like, you know, all of these things you have to decide when you self-publish, okay? Sometimes even when you contract publish, they want your input on those things. Artwork, their guidelines, they do it all versus you do the artwork that you want. Marketing, don't talk to me about marketing. Marketing, you know, I had such a problem with Author House because, remember, they have to make money and stay in business. Well, one of the ways that they do it is they kind of like use a little bit of, I'm going to just call a spade, scare tactics, okay? They use scare tactics with their authors. And like, so every time that I would call Author House to place an order, to ask a question, whatever, after my book went live, that's terminology, went live, it was published and available. My phone number gets turned over to marketing. Marketing is calling me, going, hey, we have this and such a package for this promotion and the other. And finally I said, if you guys quit calling me, then I will consider publishing Book B with you. If you don't quit calling, I'm going somewhere else. You figure it out. You know what I mean? Because it was harassment. It was so bad, right? Well, however, there's always a silver lining, right? The interesting part about all that is I got all these free ideas from their marketing guys on what I could do, right? Like email blasts and, you know, book signings is kind of, we all know about book signings once we're in writing field very long, but Facebook and just, you know, on and on. So I did most of the things, most of the ideas that they were trying to sell me, I did myself for free. Thank you very much. So we can, you know, just be gathering ideas as we go. Again, the end and the beginning. Because the writing and the publishing, it's less than half of what's involved in being an author. if you're gonna publish what you write, you have to think about that promotion. You have to. Otherwise, you have this great thing, and it's just sitting there, and nobody's reading it. So how do you get the word out? That's what it boils down to. How do you get the word out? Anything that works for you and is legal, ethical, moral is probably a good idea, right? So whether it's, like me, you see my bookmarks? Okay, I print those out myself on my little computer, double-sided. I cut them by scissors myself, and they've been fantastic. They cost me roughly 4 cents a piece, 4 to 8 cents, depending on the paper and the printer and so on and so forth. And I can carry them in my wallet. They're the right size, fits in my wallet, and it works for me, and I don't want to mess with what works, right? And I hand those out. When you're an author and you're self-published and you're self-promoting, you have to think about the fact that you are a small business. You are a small business. And what's the number one way that any business gets its best promotion? Number one source of customers for any small business? Word of mouth. Word of mouth. Okay? So, when somebody meets me, and I say to, they kind of do the usual, "Hi, who are you? What do you do for a living?" What do I say? I'm a horse whisperer? No, I say I'm an author. I've published a book. By the way, I've learned to say I've published a book rather than I've written a book, because something very cool happened is I used to say I've written a book, and they'd go, "Oh, what about?" And I'd go, "It's about a 13-year-old horse-loving girl who's suddenly thrown into the far future when world peace has finally arrived." And they'd go, "Wow, cool, that sounds really neat. When is it going to be published?" And I was like, I am so pleased that the public is educated enough to ask that question. I mean, it kept on coming up. So I had to retrain my mouth to say, "I've published a book," right? To just skip over that, question answer part of it. Because they knew, so many people knew that there's a difference between writing and publishing, right? Cool. I was like, wow, that's great. So to get out and talk to people, tell them about your book, right? This is word of mouth. This is really, really important. So you need to have something, with you, on you, that you can hand out, and you need to have your little blurb ready to go, your little one-sentence summary. And I worked on that, believe me. I just toss it out now because I've said that sentence hundreds of times. But I had to figure out what worked and listen to the feedback and listen to the questions and adjust. All right, these are all the kinds of word-of-mouth marketing things that you have to think about when you're the one promoting your book. All right, contract publishing, pros and cons. Contract publishing may seem easier, but there are major drawbacks to it, and I think writers really need to know this. For example, they may want major changes to your concept. Now, I wrote "may." What I really wanted to write was "will." Okay? Because pretty much every writer that I know has that complaint, that when the publishing house got hold of their manuscript, what's their number one goal? Sell, to stay in business, to make money, okay? So they're looking at manuscripts that they think are going to what? Sell, make money, exactly right, okay? And if they look at yours and they go, that's not, people aren't gonna like that enough, they're gonna wanna change your manuscript to be what they think is going to sell. What if you don't want to make the changes that they want? For example, I have a friend. She's a horse friend right over in Cottonwood. And she's, been in horses for a while and had a talk show radio, horse talk radio show and all kinds of stuff. She wanted to write a book about natural horse care. Okay, natural horse care, like as close as possible to keeping a horse in the wild, but they're on your property. Like, how do you do that, right? So she approached a publisher that was well known for doing horse publications. She submitted her manuscript. They accepted it. She signed the contract. Then they said, "Oh, first of all, we're going to ditch all your pictures." Because she had color artwork on almost every page. Second of all, you need to take out this part. That's too controversial. People aren't going to want this. Blah, blah. I mean, you know, she said it was a completely different book by the time they got done outlining the changes that they wanted to make. And she was so unhappy that she took the 30-day out, because often with a contract, just like buying homes or some other things, there's kind of a buyer's remorse period where some of these book contracts, you can get out of it if you get out of it within the first so many, you know, days or weeks.
Can you write an addendum to the contract specifying A, B, and C, and don't sign it until you have a legal lease?
You know, because I never went through that, I've kind of talked with authors, you know, that I've known to get my facts about the contracts. And one of the problems with the contracts is they are so hard to even figure out what's in them, and they do that on purpose, to where you really don't know what's all in there, and it's going to cost you several hundred dollars to have a lawyer go over it and tell you what's in there, right? And a lot of writers don't, because at that point, they don't have $300 to $500 to get a lawyer to go over this contract with a fine-tooth comb. And so a lot of writers just kind of go, well, I hope, you know. But so this is one of those difficulties with contract publishing, is the contract, you may not really know what's in there. It's just too hard to translate it into ordinary English. So she's one of those people that I talked to and found out, who found out, you know, after, you know, she'd gotten to the point of finding a publisher and blah, 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 that they were going to make major changes to her concept. She pulled out of it. She self-published. She and I traded books, and I totally agree with her. It's an awesome book as written, and she needs all those color pictures in there, right? So, but she had to come up with the money. She had to self-promote and so on, so on, so on. You have no say in the cover art.
It's not
true. For a contract publisher? Okay. So I need to put, you may have no say.
That's one of the things I discussed right away.
With your?
Because I have my own graphic artist doing the
publisher.
Cover. And so I asked them, I said, you know, I want my cover, my design. Oh, that's fine. Okay. That's
lucky you. Who's the publisher?
Dog-eared.
Who? Dog-eared?
Dog-eared.
Where are they located at?
It's New York. I'm not sure
very
the
cool.
Location is exactly.
Very cool.
Earlier, I think it's New York.
That's fantastic.
But they said that's fine, and I said I want it in the contract.
That's one of the exceptions then that I've ever heard of. Because even J.K. Rowling, who is one of my heroes and my role model, she had no say in her cover art. Yeah.
That was a big thing with me.
Yeah.
It's really...
It is a big thing, right? It is a big thing. And a lot of houses, when they turn it over, you know, to their team, yeah, they take care of it all for you, which the bad side of that is you don't have any say-so in it, or may not. So they might do some marketing, or you may have to anyway. Because when I talk to authors, one of the things that I hear from them is, in this time of economic crisis, when the publishing houses are trying not to go out of business, one of the first things they cut is promotion budget. In other words, sending an author, you know, on book tour and paying for that travel and paying for advertisement, paying for, you know, the flyers to be given out, whatever, whatever, that's what they cut. So when I've talked to people, they say, yeah, if you're well known, they'll still do promotions. But by definition, if you're getting into it now, you're not well known. So you're going to have to do your own promotions anyway. How interesting. Don't we wish we knew this before we had chosen, right? Very often, now I put pennies per sale. Often you make pennies per sale. When I talk to people about how much money they make per book, it's anywhere between 50 cents and just over a dollar, okay, when you go with a publishing house. Why? Because they took money from you to pay their team to do all that stuff. It's got to be paid for somewhere, right? Okay, and I didn't put it over here, but let me tell you about my book. And we can get into money more later if you want to. It's actually extremely complicated. And I don't have a chart because there's no way to chart this. But I picked the retail price on my book, okay? I set those prices. So I picked $29.99 for the hardcover and $19.99 for the softcover. Okay? When a book sells, let's put it this way, when I sell from my stock, okay, which if anybody wants to purchase a copy, we have to step outside the library, but I'd be happy to inscribe and sell a copy to you after the talk. When I sell a copy out of my stock of books, let's say it's a soft cover because it's easier to figure. So let's round that $19.99 to $20. Of that, I get a little over $10. But I had to buy that book myself. I had to buy that book. And the way that I set my prices, I paid just under $10 for a soft cover. Okay? And then I turn around and I make just over $10 selling it to somebody direct. Well, I was on book tour for the last 8 months, okay? My RV, whom I love, which I love, not a whom, which, I love that RV, but I do not love the gas mileage. It's like eight miles a gallon. And I went all over the West for 8 months. I started
at... You saved and staying rather than motels.
Well, one tank of gas is $200. Mm-hmm. Okay, one tank of gas. So how many books is that, friends? Soft covers. You guys are all as bad at math as I am. How many books is that? Yeah, Well, it's 20 books, isn't it? Why do I know this? I had to figure this out, right? Remember I said down here, be careful with marketing, you can spend thousands with little results, okay? So in the course of the roughly 400, 500 miles that my camper, my RV can drive on one tank, I had better be selling at least 20 books. Otherwise I'm losing money, right? I mean, that's just covering the cost of the book and the gas. That's not covering anything else like tolls or repairs, and I had repairs on the road, okay? And let alone what am I gonna eat, you know, and let alone if I wanna do anything extra, right? So what does it cost me to get to the people to sell them that book for 10 bucks? Oh, that money goes real quick. Does that make sense?
Did you sell 20 books?
Yes, yeah. And more. Thank goodness. But in the beginning, I didn't know. Thank you for your question, by the way, because even though I'm trying not to take questions from the audience, it allows me to explain that what I thought was a cute little niche book for spiritually oriented horse-loving girls turns out to have broad appeal to everybody who wants world peace and a hopeful outlook and is an animal lover. That's like everybody. But I didn't know that at first, right? And until I understood that this book has broad appeal and that people are perfectly happy to read about horse whispering even though they don't own any horses. And they're perfectly happy to read about a wide variety of spirituality, spiritual modes, you know, no matter whether they claim a religion or not, right? I didn't know. And I was like, how am I going to make this work financially, right? So... when I do a book signing or when I have a booth in a, let's say a farmer's market, upscale farmer's market, I have to fork out some of my 10 bucks to them. They want a cut. Why? Because they have to stay in business too, right? So usually the standard is 40%. They want 40% of the retail price. That's standard. Okay? So 40% of 20 is what?
$8.
Yeah, it's $8, right? So of that, is that right?
Yeah.
So of that 10, of my 10 profit, right? I handed over 8. How much do I have left?
12.
Right? 12, right? Of that 12, I'll just tell you, I have promised my editor another 40% because she earned it and I needed it and she was worth it. So of that 12, 40% of 12 is what? 50% would be what? Six. So let's just call it five. Okay, let's just pretend that 40% of my 12 that I have left is six. That leaves me with how much? 12 minus five is what?
Seven.
Okay, so if I do a book signing or anywhere where I'm going to a venue that somebody else has arranged and they want their 40%, then if I'm lucky, I come out of there with $4 per book. If there's no other, you know, fees or expenses or whatever, whatever. So you see, we have to think about marketing. We have to think about how are we going to make this happen, especially if we intend to have broad distribution on our book, because we run out of money real fast. Does that make sense? Good. Is that helpful for me to run through the numbers? Yeah, because it matters. It really does. Oh, and let alone that $4, it doesn't talk about repaying the original $1,100 that I had to pay the package, right? I'm just trying to pay current expenses out of that $4, right? Yeah, so it's money, money, money. Thank goodness I have a husband who's been supportive financially. Thank goodness. All right, so we talked about money. Terry? Good. So here are a few of the self-publishing houses that I'm personally aware of. There are many, many of them. Many. Just do an internet search and you're going to be overwhelmed. It's going to take you a while. Author House is the one I used. RJ Communications is another one I investigated. Lulu does a lot of advertising. If you have Gmail and you do anything about writing or publishing, their ad's going to pop up. Infinity is another one. Does anybody know Tom Hodges here? Yeah, this is what he's been doing most of his life, is publishing books either on the internet or in paper, and he has been using Infinity, and so he and I talked about that, and he told me some of the packages they have and publishing options, and they sound reputable. He's been very happy with them. Most of these places have extensive websites, and it's fairly easy to do your research in advance. All right, there are many different packages, printing arrangements. One of the cautions that I would offer you is be careful about postage and distribution arrangements. Now, here's what I mean by that. Let's say you find a really great place who will print your books really super cheap, and you neglect to ask them where those books are going to be printed super cheap. But once you do find out, one way or the other, you find out they're being printed in Malaysia. And you're going to have to pay postage from Malaysia. Oops, right? This could be a problem. So because remember, what do all publishing houses need to do? Stay in business, right? And so they are looking for ways to cut their expenses, and they don't always tell you how that's going to leave you high and dry. So be careful about where is the book going to be published and any postage that's going to be involved from the point of publishing to probably you, right? The other thing to be aware of is distribution arrangements. So let me talk a little bit about that. One of the really great things that I found out about Author House, and I just kind of lucked into this, but I'm passing this on. When I got that not quite a full recommendation from my writers group buddy, and I went onto their website, I didn't know, I just had to start with what I could really deal with. And distribution was a long ways away. But one of the things that it said on Author House's page is that they have one of the best distribution mechanisms of anybody. It turns out they're right. Let me explain what that means. Author House, after my book went live, Author House put up my book on Amazon.com and in three Uber distributor channels, mechanisms, companies, I don't know what to call them, Uber distributors. Those three Uber distributors, I'm going to give you their names, and if you're serious about self-publishing, you need to write these down. R.R. Bowker, R.R. Bowker, R.R. B.O.W.K.E.R. had to think how to spell Bowker for a minute. And Baker and Taylor. And I'll think of it in a minute.
These are distributors.
These are Uber distributors, okay? Each one of these Uber distributors is partners with thousands, I'm saying tens of thousands, of small and independent bookstores. Okay.
You're saying Uber,
O-B-E-R? You with an umlaut, B-E-R.
I'm sorry, say again.
U, B-E-R. And if you got umlauts on your phone, put those above the U, the two dots. Seems like it begins with an I, but I need to put it on the slide. So when I was on book tour and learning as I went, I rolled into Portland, Oregon, and I had a good time, as I do everywhere. And people asked me, oh, so is this book available at Powell? And I said, just a minute. Let me find out. I think so. And I called up Powell, and I said, hi, I'm an author. I published this book. And she says, what's the name of your book? And I said, Abby Wise, Away. And she says, just a minute, please. Click, 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 click. Yes, your book's in our system. How may I help you? Right? I mean, this is like the Jerusalem of bookstores. It is, you know? And I'm in their system. Why? Because I chose the right self-publishing company. Because they put it in with, you know, their Uber distributors, all three of them. And that means that whoever works through those three, any of those three channels, can order my book. And I didn't have to lift a finger. This is huge. It's huge. If you...
How many have you sold through that process?
You know, I can give you my total sales. My total sales is just over 600 as of this week, which is very respectable for a self-published book. But you know, think of the publishing. Like, the orders go through whatever channel they go through, and then the distributor publishes the book, and I don't necessarily know which, you know, channel it came through. Mm-hmm. Okay? So I know what I sell, I know what Amazon sells, I know what Author House sells, and I know what all other channels sell. Those are the figures that I have access to. Okay. So when you look at... Okay, so for example, I was looking into RJ Communications to reprint because I'm having the good problem of starting to run out of my books. And I looked into RJ, and yeah, they can print cheaper for me, but no Amazon and only one Uber distributor. And I was like... Eh, it's true, you get what you pay for, huh? Right? So, you know, Author House is costing me a little bit more, but for the purposes of my book, which I want worldwide distribution to all English-speaking countries for my book, and the distribution system is something that's really important to me. But if you want to do just a little family genealogy, like my mom did, and print out at most 20 copies... And those first, you know, free 20 copies or 10 or whatever is going to be most of what you need. You don't care about worldwide distribution. Excellent. Go with somebody like RJ. You see how you have to think about what your project needs and then match up your company. And it's going to take some research. Okay? I still can't think of that third Uber distributor. Yeah, Tara.
How about a little bit of that?
You know, they advertise a lot. People seem happy with them. I don't know what their distribution system is. That, you know, whatever you're thinking about going with, it needs checking out.
One well-known publishers, you should check out the Stars distribution.
Of course. Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Check out everything. Good. So let me talk just a bit about the costs again. So self-publishing, what I paid up front just for getting in their system and having them set up my type, you know, make sure the artwork was printable, justify the cover so it's, you know, prints out correctly, get in their system, was about $1,100. Then it was about another $100 because I paid them to register for my ISBN and my copyright. Raise your hand if you do not know what ISBN is, and I will explain it. Okay, ISBN is International Standard Book Number, and it's on the back of the book. This is the ISBN, okay? And it's a stock number, right? It's a stock number for a book. And you have to register for that, and that costs money, right? So you pay for it. So, and then your copyright, you know, means that you have registered it with the Library of Congress, filed for copyright, and nobody can steal. Well, people can steal it, but then you can sue them and win. That's what it boils down to. Oh, goody, doesn't that sound like fun? No. However, the you don't have to have an ISBN and a copyright. You don't have to. Right? So if you just want to publish something for your family, you're not worried about people ripping it off, you're not worried about stocking it in a bookstore, then you don't have to worry about that. Okay? But it was sure great, right when I was trying to deal with final artwork, final corrections, you know, everything, that they filed the ISBN and copyright for me. Gosh, that was worth another $100. Contract publishing. Once in a while, the contract publishers will give you an advance. Anybody heard of an advance when you're writing a book or a novel, right? Well, that's kind of gone by the wayside also. Anymore, if they give you an advance, it comes off the profits. Okay, it didn't always used to. But I have a good friend, Karen Ann Webb is her name, and she publishes fantasy fiction. She's a friend of mine in Utah. And so she's one of those people that has been dealing with publishing companies going out of business like every month. Like she had four different contracts with four different publishing houses, and like one by one they went out of business, like one a month. She was like, what, am I cursed? You know, I sign up with them and then they go out of business. It was really awful for her. Well, what she told me is that even though she's, you know, been out there for a while, she's not a new author. Yet when she signed up with her latest publishing house, hoping they wouldn't go out of business, they didn't even offer her any advance for her upcoming manuscript. It was like, yeah, you're lucky we're giving you a contract. You know, you're lucky we're agreeing to publish your work. But all bets were off as far as marketing money, advances, you know, help publicizing, anything. They're just like, you know, Scrooge. I mean, it's totally close to the vest time anymore. If they offer you an advance at all, it's going to come off of your royalties from sales. Wow. So we need to be aware that that's what's happening in the industry these days. The other thing with contract publishing is when you're a new author, they want tons and tons and tons and tons of paperwork. They want prospectives, they want bios, they want summaries, they want first three chapters, they want, you know, on and on and on in special format, this and that. Well, I found that too when I was shopping for a publisher. And I think, and so does Karen Ann Webb think, that it's to weed out the people who aren't really serious. It's a time waster. It feels like a time waster, and we think it is. And so, back to the, it takes oodles and oodles and oodles of time, even just to find a publisher. And you have to check your contract very carefully. What is the deal on royalties? Who owns the rights? I have known more than one person, photography, as well as, you know, text writer, that they found out after the fact that they had lost all rights to their work. once it was turned over, and they had no recourse because they had signed something they didn't understand, and bye-bye, that was it. Any other limitations? You have to just be really, really careful, because these companies, unfortunately, really don't have any interest in protecting your rights. They have every interest in keeping their bottom line and making as much money as they can. Okay, Terry. Good. Believe it or not, that covers the self-publishing part. Because it's one big tangle, isn't it? Let's deal with the second part. How do I know if I can or should write the book I have in mind? Let's talk about writing. Yay, Terry. Writing? Go ahead. Bingo. So, I love to talk about writing. Let's talk about ideas. Raise your hand if you've had blank page syndrome. What is that? Blank page syndrome is where you're like, okay, it's my time to write. I should write for whatever reason. And I have nothing to say. And you're looking at the blank screen or the blank page. And you stare and you stare. I don't have it either. I didn't raise my hand. Okay? Let me talk about ideas. Are you all familiar with the book Inkheart by Cornelia Funke? It got turned into a movie. It's cute. It's a kid's book. Well, because my genre is young adult, I read a lot of young adult. And this is a young adult. Very interesting. She's a German writer, and whoever translated it did a fabulous job translating the German into English. It's beautifully written. And Cornelia Funke, in the extras feature at the end of the DVD of the movie that was made out of her book, she was showing her cottage in Germany, you know, where she lives. And there's a pond with, you know, plants around it. And she said, "This is where I come to catch my ideas." And I'm like, "Huh? What? Yeah." And she said, "In the book, when I wrote the character who chases ideas with a butterfly net, it's because I would be down here weeding or planting or whatever, and an idea would come to me, and I learned the hard way, if I did not capture that idea right then, it was gone forever." And she is totally, totally right, and I love that analogy. It's completely accurate, so that's why I put catching butterflies and the little graphic there of the person with the net. And the light bulb. So what it boils down to for me, and what I love talking about, is how to capture ideas. Because if you're here in this room, you are thinking about writing, and that means you are talking about capturing ideas and putting them down on paper. There are many steps to doing that successfully. Let me share with you a little bit about what I have discovered. I've discovered that wherever I am, especially when I'm doing mundane work, like weeding a garden, okay, like cleaning, like dishes, like showering, like any driving, especially driving, you've got to have a system to capture your ideas, because that is the time when your mind is just kind of like, you know, free-flowing, spinning. That's when you're very likely to have some really great ideas. And if you don't capture them right then, they're gone, possibly forever. So how are you going to do this? Well, let me share with you what I do. I have a bunch of little papers about that big that I cut myself. And I just have those everywhere, like, you know, clipped to things and rubber banded to things and weighted down, and they're just kind of like in piles, and I know where those piles are around the house and in the car. However, it's hard to write when you're driving. It's hard to write when your hands are wet from doing the dishes, you know, or cleaning the sink or whatever. And so I also use my phone. My phone has a voice recorder in it, okay? And all I have to do, I have an iPhone. Anybody else have an iPhone? No? Well, the iPhone screen, it doesn't go by pressure, it goes by warmth. Okay, and if I have gloves on, the warmth can't get through. So I use my tongue to bend you over so I can speak, right? If I have no hands, right? Hilarious, the things that we do. I also have, in desperation, if all I have is my Bluetooth on, I've called my my home tape, my home phone, and left a message, and then I go retrieve it off. Right. So these are the things that we need to do. We need to get really creative in capturing our ideas, because once they're gone, they may be gone forever. Not every idea that we have and that we capture can be used, however. So then there's a whole sorting and fitting process, all right? That's what this is for. So the ideas that we have, what I do, like for example, these days I'm 381 pages into my book B, as I call it, my first sequel. And I have stacks of notes, and they're by category, and I have a laundry line of ideas. It's my laundry line of ideas. It's just a piece of string tacked up to my curtain, my valance, and then I clip with clothespins or paper clips. I clip the ideas by category. So, for example, I have a bunch of ideas about the computers of the future. Those are all in one clip. I have a bunch of ideas about school. I have a bunch of ideas about animals, you know, on and on. And so when I have an idea, then I categorize them up on my laundry list. Then when I need one of those ideas, I know where to go, okay?
It's storyboarding.
It's a little bit of a storyboard. Awesome. Bill, right? Yes. Very good. Good. All right. Terry? Cool. Let's talk a little bit about methods of writing. So there's a very linear approach. My book A was very linear, where I would like, okay, first this happens, then this, now I want to work in this. And I did a lot of going back and forth between my notes and my computer screen. And it was very, you know, A, B, C, D, E, okay? Book B is just a lot more free-flowing, seat of the pants, winging it, on a, you know, a wing and a prayer sort of a thing. So I put spiritual up there. I'm writing with a lot of blanks, a lot of question marks, asterisks. I have over 400 comments. Is anybody here not using a computer to write your work? Everybody's on computer, is that correct? Okay, so you're all using Word. Do y'all know how to use the comments function on your Word? It's vital when you're writing and creating something, okay? So this is a real usable tip I can give y'all. In Word, when you go up to the insert on the menu, the top menu bar, that words, it says file, edit, okay, insert, I think it's the third one over. There's a choice under there that says comments. Click on comments. Well, you got to put your cursor where you want the comment to be inserted. You don't have to highlight anything. You can if you want. Click on comments, and then a little window pops up over in a margin. An extra wide margin is created over to the right, and you can type in there. Ah, wow, is this vital? Because I'll write stuff, and I'll have something in mind as to why I wrote it. Well, I've learned the hard way. If I don't write a comment to myself about why I put it in there, or, oh, be sure and include, you know, tie this into this later, and because my stories are richly woven. They're very dense. So a clue up here is going to reverberate mid-story, and it's going to have fruition and payoff at the end. Well, it's wonderful to read, and it's very hard to write that way. I couldn't do it without the comments function. Right now, with my book B, at 381 pages, I have 450 comments. Okay? What I love about that is that I don't have to remember any of those comments. My brain is free to, you know, create and go off on whatever. If I had to remember that, no way, would not happen, right? No way. So, this winging it, if you've got your technology well in hand, you can wing it better. Does that make sense? So, you know, I've been accused of being over-organized more than once, and I laugh, because that tells me they don't have a clue what's involved in writing. They think that it's all just flows from heaven through my fingertips magically onto the page. Not, I have to capture those ideas, organize them so that I can find them when I need them, refer to them often to keep me back on track, you know, use my comment functions, know how I'm doing stuff, then I can be freewheeling, right? Yeah.
Well, it sounds like you think digitally, and the rest of us probably still think analog.
That's so cute, Terry. So I love that.
You're the next generation, that generation kind of passed me by.
It's true that I have, you know, I have an exceptionally well-organized mind. It really helps because very early I told myself that I wanted to write not just a good novel, but a great novel. Well, let me tell you, it's hard enough to write any book. It's really difficult to write a good book. It's nearly impossible to write a great book. And yet that was always my goal. Well, how are you going to do that? How are you going to do something that's nearly impossible? Well, there's going to be a long list of qualities and skills involved there, right? Perseverance, you know, organization, clarity, knowing how to solve problems, full of problems. The creative endeavors are full of problems to be solved, so we have to be good problem solvers. Now, I put mix here, and what I mean by that is a mix of linear and spiritual, okay? So a mix of you know, a promise and a prayer, and being highly organized. Whatever works for you, that's really the bottom line. Whatever works for you. Please don't think that you have to write like I write. You probably aren't even writing the same kind of stuff anyway, right? So if you're not writing the same kind of stuff, it's going to need a different approach anyway. Whatever works for you, when you know yourself well enough to assess what's working and what's not working, right? Then you're going to do more of what does work and less of what doesn't work, or go get help with what's not working. That's the benefit of a writer's group. Okay, now far be it from me to claim that I've got it all figured out between linear, spiritual, and a mix of the two. If you've got an other and it works, use it. If it's none of those, yes?
As you're writing the sequel, do you find yourself reverting to some sort of a formula that you developed in the first place?
Yeah, no. Well, the only formula that I have, and again, I borrowed this because I'm a huge Harry Potter fan. Harry Potter was a direct inspiration for my book in several ways. There was an interview, like a review of her work, and it kind of said, yeah, it's kind of formulaic where Harry always starts out, you know, the books always start out with the end of summer, Harry, and then school starts, and he goes to Hogwarts, and he has all these hair-raising adventures, and then he returns home. And I was like, guys, you totally missed it. Yeah, that's like the time frame or that's the setting, but it's not that way. Well, so if I was going to boil it down, yeah, mine has, you know, a similar formula where we catch up with Abby at her home where she's miserably unhappy with a terrible home life, and then she has, you know, some kind of hair-raising adventure, accident, I guess I need to say, and she slides unconsciously, she slides not of her own volition 700 years into the far future when, you know, the world is basically perfect. And then she has another accident to bring her back home by the end of the book where she struggles because she's been somewhere so fabulous and she doesn't want to be back home. So there's sort of that formula that's going to happen in every book, but aside from that, there's no formula to my books. And I really do let the book and the characters tell me what needs to be done. There's just a flow, right? And when you read enough works of your genre, you start getting a sixth sense for how that flow needs to go. You know, for like, oh, I need some dialogue here. I have that. I have that in my book B. I have, you know, describe setting more. You know, I'm going to come back to it later because I don't know where they are. Not really. I don't know what the surroundings are, but I know it needs to be there, because otherwise I've lost the reader, right? Whenever we write, we always, every word have to be thinking, what is the reader's experience? Always. And if you don't know what the reader's experience is, go to your list of people who volunteer to be your readers and say, here, would you read this? And tell me what your feedback is, right? So back to what I said, collect names of people willing to give you that feedback. Terry? So here I am in Yellowstone Park this summer. There's my laundry list of ideas above me. I have two computers. For some reason, I only had one going at that time. Oh, I know why. I'd already used up the battery on the first one. There's no electricity where I was. My notebook, that's one of my notebooks of my time frames and characters. My map of travels up above, where I have my book route mapped out. This is my portable box of books, which I'm nearly running out of books, I'm pleased to say.
You say your time frame notebook.
Mm-hmm.
That's for keeping your sequence.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, these are the tools that we have to have in order to keep things straight and have consistency, right? So if we're Tuesday here, and then 2 days later we're Wednesday, wait, it should be Thursday. I mean, these are the things that we have to plan all out. And the reader may or may not care, right?
But you need a box of clothespins. That's great.
Well, you think I need more?
Well, I think that's pretty elegant.
I have more, but my laundry line is full. Not that I can't get more. But so this is inside my RV, whom I named Ebenezer. That's a whole other story. But I was trying to write while I was on book tour. Guess what? It doesn't really work. You can do one or the other. So that's another piece of advice I bring to you, having done book tour for 8 months, and I'm going to be doing it again, God willing, knock on wood. But I've realized I cannot write while I'm on book tour. It's too, my time is taken in just like finding where to plug in and water and giving the talks I have and on and on and on. So now that I'm, back home here, I force myself to spend time on my book every day. I don't always make it, or let's say I don't always make new progress, but I force myself to do something on book B every day, okay? Even if it's just, go transfer the notes from one clip to another because I'm vacating Ebenezer because Ebenezer needs repairs, because, wow, this thing is complicated. This thing called writing is complicated. All right, so that's a fun picture for y'all. Terry? Educate yourself. Writing is a job. Just think of the writing that you do as a job, whether you're getting paid for it or not. And it needs training. How do you get training? Well, there's classes online or in the classroom. Yay, Judy! And Bill? Yay!
I'm going to go to school since 2000. I'll never graduate.
Professional student. Yeah, I've known a few of those. And then reading, both, this is where I was making the point of reading other people's works. And what I mean, get opinions, is start developing opinions about what you read. Okay, so for example, when I read, I'll just be blunt because there's no, I'm entitled to have an opinion, the Twilight series. Okay, now I've told you I loved Harry Potter, loved it. Well, there's parts of it I didn't love, but overall, loved it. Tried to read Twilight, hated it, could not stand it. Poorly written, unbelievable. Unbelievable in a bad way, not credible is what I mean there. And I just had a real, real problem with that. You know what? It's valuable to know what you don't like. Not, I'm not saying go read stuff that you hate, but I'm saying when you run across something that you don't like, take a minute, sit down and say, why don't I like this? Why? Bring it up to conscious mind, you know, do a little writing exercise of your own, either rewrite it or tell why you don't like it or what. Incredibly valuable to know what you don't like. Why? Because then hopefully when it comes, you know, time for you, you get into that point and you're like, uh-oh, this is sounding like thingy that I didn't like. And then you're going to take it another direction, okay? So that you can stick with things that you do like. And then practice. Practice your job of writing, whether it's a blog, you know, on the internet, or, you know, journaling by longhand, whatever it might be, family letters. One of the biggest encouragements I had, even though I have a degree in journalism and had been writing for years, mainly nonfiction, when I wrote my family letters and sent those out every year at holiday time, the feedback that I got was actually one of the things I kept in mind when I started to think about writing a book. Because a couple of people consistently said, I like the way that you write. It's not just, oh, we liked hearing from you. Oh, it's good to catch up. They said, we like the way that you write. We look forward to your letters every year and we read them out loud because basically they're saying they're well written. They liked my voice. And I held on to that, right? It's in the beginning that we need encouragement. It's not after we're successful, right? All right, Terry. Plot, weaving and carding. Ooh, I love this slide. So I mentioned to you that I weave my plots densely. So for example, I'll introduce a concept early or a phrase, and then I will repeat it or touch on it again, you know, mid-book. And then if it's a really major element, then I'll tie it up again in the beginning, I mean, at the very end. Or there will be things that I just mention kind of, you know, a third of the way through and then contrast them in the perfect future, you know, whatever, 100, 150 pages later, right? So this weaving, it's really hard to do. It takes a lot of comments, it takes a lot of notes, it takes a lot of going over and over and over, but it makes for a rich read. Does that make sense? It's really about the emotional journey. A work of art, a created work, is all about an emotional journey. And I got that comment off the director's comments at the end of a movie reel I watched one time, and I liked it so much I stole it and filed off the serial numbers, and yet now I'm using it. That director said that if he does his job well, the person, you know, when they're done watching the movie, say, wow, I really like that movie. But hopefully what they mean is that was a satisfying emotional journey. Do you see? That's what I want to do in my book. I want to give somebody a satisfying emotional journey. How do you do that? You make it rich and you take them through a variety of emotions. So there are portions that I intend to be funny. There's portions, passages that I want to be sad. There's parts that I want to be a little bit scary. I don't do horror, I don't do gruesome, I don't do, you know, my book's very uplifting, and I found out there's a huge demand for that. People want uplifting. In fact, J.J. Abrams, you guys know who J.J. Abrams is? He was one of the creators of the TV show Lost. He was the main writer of the new Star Trek, and he was also one of the main producers of Cowboys and Aliens movies. And I've read a number of interviews by him. Very creative, very disciplined guy. Interesting. And he said in Wired magazine, which I read along with a lot of other magazines about upcoming technology, he said that the gruesome apocalyptic productions are over. They've had their day. He said, I know, right? He said, you know, horrible scenes people are really tired of. And I've put that up on my website because that's what I find. When I traveled the West, When I talk to people, one of the most common comments I get is, wow, it would be a nice change to read something uplifting, right? So I, you know, the scary that I wrote in is just everyday scary. It's not, you know, that's one of the things I don't like about Harry Potter. Oh, do we have to do ultimate evil takes over the world, fight to the death again? Do we have to? Right? Well, there's so much else I loved about Harry Potter that I put up with that. But you know, I kind of wrote my book like, okay, what if Harry Potter had had an uplifting adventure full of discoveries and personal growth in a magical, mystical place instead of horrible things happening trying to kill him every turn, you know? So when I weave in, you know, my things, I'm looking at plucking the emotions of the reader. And you should too. Almost no matter what you're writing, even if it's straight up factual. Carding. I love this picture of this lady. Okay, I have actually carded wool. Anybody else actually carded wool ever? Yay! So, what you do is you get this hunk of raw wool and you put it on these two cards, which are needle boards with handles, okay? And they've got all these, like, you know, needles sticking up. And you just start going like this. And what it does is it gets the fibers lying in the same direction so that then you can spin it on your spinning wheel into a fiber, and then you can weave it, right? So very definitely I have the image in mind when I'm reading, especially, you know, along about the 15th or 20th revision, I'm carding. I'm getting everything smoothly going in the same direction. Nothing should block the flow, the emotional flow of the reader. If they stumble over awkward wording, if it's a tongue twister, even in their mind, that's not, you know, interesting or helpful, you need to change it. It needs to all lie smooth. It needs to just flow. Flow is one of those artistic words that you hear and you're like, what does it mean? Well, in the sense of a book, it's about, is there anything that stops the reader's reading? That's what flow is in the sense of reading, okay? Neat stuff. I love this stuff. Terry? Good. So at some point, we wonder, is my writing any good? Remember I told you that I would talk about should I and when should I write this project that I have in mind? This is starting to get into that stuff. Well, there are standards of writing that can be learned, that can be talked about, terminology. You know, I'm sure that you address a lot of this in your class, Judy. You know, meter, as far as poetry, meter, rhyme, you know, stanzas, all that kind of stuff. E.E. Cummings with no capitalization, or standard with capital, right? These are things that can be just talked about in very academic, intellectual terms. And when you're talking about prose, which is just regular sentences, you know, then there are things like subject-verb agreement and parenthetical, you know, correct use of parentheses, not too much dashes, correct use of colons versus semicolons, on and on. This is like the nuts and bolts, the technical parts of it. Definitely they can be learned, definitely, and talked about, and it's very helpful to do that. Feedback. Once you kind of, you have enough there to start getting feedback from whoever, then you have two, I have two things to offer about feedback. One is reviews. So you may give it to somebody and you may say, please tell me what you think. Please give me a review of this. And maybe they write it as an actual book review, which is something very specific, or maybe they just kind of, you know, say, I like this, I didn't like that. Everything is valuable. Negative feedback especially is priceless. It's difficult to take, but you want this. You want to be improving all the time. How do you improve? By finding out what's not working for some reader or another. Now maybe you get feedback. I had this happen. I'll give you a specific instance. So I had somebody in Fiji, a friend of mine, acquaintance of mine in Fiji, order the book and read it. And she had told me up front that she just really hates it when books ride the coattails of a popular product. So when I told her that my character, Abby Wise, reads Harry Potter and that Harry Potter is mentioned in my book, she said, oh, I'm going to hate it. And I was like, okay, well, read it and tell me, right? She did. She told me, yeah, remember I told you? Yeah, I hated that. You need to take that out. If you ever do a revision or a reprint, you need to just take that out. Well, first of all, she was tactless in saying you should. Okay, those are button pushers, big time. Don't tell people what they should do, right? So I was able to like fight my way through her pushing my buttons and just say, thank you for your feedback. Thank you for your feedback. And I knew that it was her, not me. I knew that for two reasons. One is she's the only one out of several dozen that have said that. She told me before she read it she has a problem with that. Okay. And the other is the taking in context with the rest of her comments. She just has some quirks, some just real, you know, things that she likes and doesn't like. Everyone's entitled to have that. It doesn't mean I need to change my book just because she has a quirk, right? So there's a line in there. There's a line in there of staying true to your vision, okay? That's where I put this here. What to keep and what to change. A lot of it is just like, oh, okay, God, what do I do here? You know, she's slammed me. She's ripped me one end to the other. And you just have to sort through it. It's a test. You know, life is not for sissies. That's what a friend of mine said a while ago. And so this is just one of those things where we have to kind of, you know, man up or woman up and just deal with somebody throwing rocks at our windows and work through it. There is, however, you know, training and just that sense you get from doing this a while as to what you think is going to fly and not fly with different audiences, different readers, what you're happy with, what seems to work with the flow that, you know, that comes from experience. That's what this means, training. Okay. I'm going to stop there and ask for any questions at this point. I'm going to ask for any questions. How do you do that? What does that mean? I love that question. So Barbara's question is, what do you mean when you say you listen to the book write itself, or you let the characters take over?